Hi. The backstory in this episode is a cruise in the what is called the territorial waters between Puar in the south of Vizhinjam fishing harbor and Akkam north of the fishing harbor, covering a span of land distance of just about 40 kilometers. This study is actually part of the program proposal we had submitted, MSD has submitted to the Harbor Engineering Division. The logistics required are: one, a platform, a vessel, which is actually a 24-foot long boat, which is used by ISRO for some surveillance purposes and is nicknamed as Survey Vessel Rocket. Then, locating the location offshore is actually those days not by using what is called marine surveyors. We had two marine surveyors working with us in the cruise program and affiliated to the Harbor Engineering Department, and they will use what is called a sextant. And what sextant does is, you are in the platform, the surveyors, both of them, and we have a bathymetric chart of the ocean. And then they will look at, using the sextant, on two land-based objects that are visible within, 14 kilometers, anywhere between 0 and 14 kilometers range. And they will draw two lines. They will take a reading, that's all, in what is called in degrees, in circular degrees. And then then those two rays are, the objects are identifiable in the given in the topographic sheet, or bathymetric chart also. So by drawing two rays in that particular angle in the map, and at their intersection will be where the surveyor stood or the boat was at that point of doing their reading. Anyway, another point work is, we had a plan to collect one sample each at 20 meter water depth and 40 meter water depth in each transect. For that, we used a van bean grab that was actually taken on loan from the regional center of the CEFS in Kochi. Then what else we had was, we had people. We have bathymetric chart, we have surveyors, we have the grabber device, sediment grabber. So then the boat had something like a winch, that's all. So there is no A-frame. So one of the things in working in water depths of 20, 40 meter, it's not very difficult, but there is some element of risk, because while pulling the sediment grab up is very easy, but taking it out of the water will be tough. So we had improvised the A-frame. A-frame is something that people know what an A-frame is. It's a frame fashioned, tubular frame fashioned like alphabet, uppercase A, and then fitted to a shaft, rotating platform, etc. So that is available in all the research vessels, and depending upon the size of the vessel, the size of the A-frame, and the capacity of winch will be huge. And the so-called winch in this boat was only 100 meter depth. Or it is actually a wire rope wound upon a drum, and which is driven by what is called a small electric motor. So these are the things that we needed. Then we had identified something like 11 transects, southernmost one from Puvar, at Puvar. Then another one somewhere along what is called the Karichal Kail, off along the beach. And then another one in Adimalathura, yet another one somewhere little north of Kovalam, then another one in Sangamugam, and so on and so forth, finally ending at Vakkam. So we are all set. We planned it very carefully, and we had everything. We had actually planned for a 7 day of work in the ocean. And I participated in for the first 3 days. In the first 3 days, we had actually finished up work in two tracks. Okay, what I also did not mention is we had also what is called an echo sounder fitted to the boat. So we know what is the water depth, we know what the location is with the help of the surveyors. And we have a winch to which we will attach our grab, and we will grab and pull the sample out. Okay, so that part of the work is, you know, what you call the infra for collection of sample with the correct location, etc. Excellent. Then we started working from the Puvar, and the next one, Karichal Kail, and these two were could be completed on the same day. That is the advantage. And then when we came to Adimalathura, we did that in the second day of work. Third, and as well as we did one more transect somewhere south of Shankumugam on the second day. So four are down. Yes. In other words, Puvar, Karichal, Adimalathura, then Shankumugam in 2 days. Then my team, which consisted of the team consisted of me, Terry Machado, Mr. Nair, and Vasudevan, plus two of the surveyors. And we had a technical helper on board also. Technical helper is some kind of a last grade the employee of the SES in the Marine Sciences Division. You know, we actually alternated. We did not take the same person every day because they will feel bad. Yeah, either because of the excitement of working in the ocean or because of the, you know, their inability to appreciate the work in the ocean. Anyway, on the fourth day on, there was a plea from, I joined on the fourth day also, then there was a plea that there is no need for the MSD to accompany the cruise, and my group is all seasoned to work in the area, etc. But there was one problem. As we proceeded northerly, more and more to the north, what had happened was, the boat had to cruise for at least hour and a half, and occasionally 2 or 3 hours. So when the northernmost the transect along Vakkam was completed, as always we have been doing, we departed from the Vizhinjam Harbour, because Vizhinjam Harbour is the only place we can come to shore and go to, you know, safely berth and, you know, board or go off to the ocean for work. In other words, another interesting thing that needs a very important mention is this boat has no communication device. Keep that in mind. No communication. If you are in distress, all that you can do is you can steer the boat. The crew will steer the boat to the near shore area. Luckily, the boat is also not certified for use at night because there are no such communication devices or headlights or flashlights or whatever. Nothing is there. So we had to start off in the early morning and we had to come home in the evening before sunset, during the daylight only. So as we went northerly, you know, we could do only our team could do only one profile a day. So obviously, because we have to go from Vizhinjam Harbour northerly to reach the transect location. So anyway, to conclude, it was a very successful work, and we had collected 11 into 22 samples from the offshore. That is one. Number two, we had 11 what is called echo sounded sounding strip chart record, and then we had, of course, definitely the exact location of the sample points. Then we did not carry any current meter of any sort. And you know, one of the things that needs mention is, you know, Terry is well versed with you know, working in the coastal waters. When he was a research assistant or whatever, attached to National Institute of Oceanography, what is called INS, no, research vessel Gaveshini, was a, what is called a barge. A barge is a boat with a flat bottom, unlike a ship, which has a V-shaped cross section. So advantage of barge is that you can land on the shore itself, absolutely no problem. Whereas the RV rocket, survey vessel rocket, not RV research vessel, no, RV survey vessel rocket cannot, you know, just head toward the beach and land in the beach. Beaching in the land needs a barge-like bottom. Anyway, so the sampling was actually not very difficult, but the difficulty is when they grab surfaces, then it is too heavy actually. It is too heavy, no doubt about it. You need a strong arms, strong legs, as well as very much, very strong body control. This, because you have to safeguard yourself also. That is one. Number two, when this grab is going down, free fall actually, there will be bottom current, very severe bottom current or very low bottom current, but some kind of bottom current will be in the very close to the seabed, whatever, or very close to the seabed and not in the seabed, okay, very close to. Then the whole grab will be dragged by the current. So we had no device to measure the velocity of the current that is dragging the van being grabbed. Anyway, so because Cherry had this onboard experience in RV Gaveshini, the bar that used by NIO in the very early days for research, had actually contributed to the huge success of our operations. Then, of course, you know, all the samples came to our laboratory. Laboratory just had maintained our MSD, another building in the north side of Shastamangalam Junction, where we had taken all the samples. And, you know, people knew, people were told what is the different steps in the processing of the samples. And for cleaning, etc. So, you know, this is all known. Then, finally, our intention is to do the what is called the color of the sample. That is very important. You know, as soon as the sample is taken out and the sample of the sample is dried in the natural light natural light only, because in Trivandrum you don't need any artificial light to heat it up. In other words, you know, the data number is sufficient enough to, you know, get the water moisture out of the sample. And then we did not make use of any color chart, you know, any color chart to note the sample color. We were verbally describing the color. The reason is very simple. You know, if the sediment was idling in the seabed, it will be coated with iron Fe2O3, okay, ferric iron. If the sample had been constantly in the move, if the sediment had been constantly in the move, you know, it will be, color will be not as deep and intense. In other words, when you have a idling sediment sitting where, it means that even during monsoon, the sediment movement is nil. That's all. If, on the other hand, if you have a coloration which is not uniform, or you have more abrasion around the corners and edges of the grit particles, then it is an indication that, you know, sediment was sitting there, but occasionally it got abraded because of the currents. That is a erosion and then further deposition. So these things, in order to catch these things, we will have to do the texture first, and then each fraction was observed under the microscope, a binocular microscope. And I had told, you know, Terry was actually the man behind all this work. I had to admit that. Then, you know, Terry, these are the things you have to watch for, because we want to know whether the sediment at the, you know, 20 meter depth or 40 meter depth is affected by the coastal currents, underwater currents. So this is what you have to track. But to our interest, to our surprise, Terry came back and asked me, sir, shall we go to the other laboratory in Shastramangala? I said, well, what, is there anything exciting? Yes, sir, I saw something exciting. I was looking at the, you know, on our, we were walking over to the, you know, it's only in a walking distance. Within 5 minutes, we will be in the other building. And Terry said, sir, while we were walking, sir, I saw some peculiar grains in there. Now, and then I said, okay, let us have a look at it. So we took the sample and put a portion of it in the, what is called a petri dish. And I started carefully looking through the binocular microscope, and alas, there is a very interesting piece of particle, which is pellet shaped. Yeah, pellet is, can be any of any shape. It is capsule-like pellets, and it is not one or two, there are many. This is the point. And all of them are dark grass green in color. Then I was very familiar with what is called a glauconite, how it appears on the microscope and so on and so forth, because I had extracted glauconite from what is the Koilon limestone of Kerala, samples of Koilon limestone of Kerala. So I said, really, it is glauconite. That means there is actually absolutely no movement of sediment, at least during the Holocene, during some part of the Holocene, because glauconite will form as an orthogenic mineral only when there is no or minimal terrestrial sediment getting into the waters of the sea. So this is a conventional wisdom that all the geologists have been holding close to their chest, because glauconite is actually a clay pellet, capsule shaped pellet or spherical pellet or whatever, which is actually the excreta of the fish, of the water, the fauna of the water, fish like fauna. And when they go and sit, in, because they are large in size, they can easily settle through the water column. When they sit in the sea floor, in the seabed, and in an environment, in a situation where there is no influx of terrestrial material, then the so-called orthogenic process will set in. And the what is called the clay pellet can be, you know, made of combination of chlorite, illite, monomeronite, or only monomeronite, or only chlorite and monomeronite, or illite and monomeronite, whatever. But these are all clays, and this will attract the Fe2O3 ions. That is what happens. And once that is loaded with Fe2O3 ions, the color changes, and it is called a glauconite. Because, you know, a guy by name D.M. Triplehorn, way back in 1965 or 66, published a paper in Earth Science Reviews. It is actually a review article where he classified glauconite into four types. One is pure elect, then another is monmorillonite, then finally a mixed mineral glauconite, which is actually what is called what we have. And not only that, these are actually the excreta of the fauna. And that was actually proved by a USGS geologist by name Pryor, who had given a feed of finely divided clay particles and to an aquarium with fish. A clay particle given this turbulence level anywhere in the ocean today or any time in the past will not settle to the bottom. But if you have a clay settling associated with the sediment, it means that the clay particles were aggregated to sizes larger than 2 microns, and one of the most interesting intervention is caused by the induction of clay by the what is called the aquatic fauna or the marine fauna, and their excreta will be of the size of medium sand or even coarse sand that can easily settle down as a particle of sand through the water column in spite of the turbulence. So I will go back to the third part of the study on behalf of Vizhinjam Fisheries Harbor Project in the next episode. There are also very interesting finds then too.